Let's go through an example of some quality assurance processes that we just talked about in that last video lesson. These data are from a bromide tracer test at a woodchip bioreactor where we dump a concentration of a solution of bromide in and then sample the bioreactor outlet for bromide over time. The application doesn't matter so much. This is just an example of the analysis run from my lab that allows us to see examples of the quality assurance process that we just discussed. The very first thing I do when I have new data is to graph it. This is one of the most important quality assurance processes. So you can see I'm going to graph it. And I would add axis labels, of course, like you're supposed to, but what I can see is that the samples all look how they should. There's nothing suspiciously high, there's nothing suspiciously too low, no weird zeros coming through. This allows me to quickly assess that the data look right for me. Here, the shape of the data looks right because I know my bromide concentration should increase and then decrease. But the one thing that does flag me immediately is there's some negative values, which I can see in here. And then looking back to my numbers, I see right here and right here, two samples are coming up negative in the analytical file that I got from the lab. You can never have negative concentrations. That just physically doesn't make sense. It doesn't matter what your analyte is. In water, you can never have a negative concentration. So let's jump over to our calibration curve and check what our calibrated range was. And you see my calibration range was 10. If a sample comes back at above 10, it needs to be diluted and then rerun. And then my lowest, my detection limit, my low detection limit is 0.5. And so what I see, in fact, I have quite a few samples that are below 0.5. And I can use conditional formatting, in fact, conditional formatting, highlight cells, less than 0.50. So I have quite a few samples that are coming back from my analytical equipment as lower than my detection limit. So let's clean these data a little bit so that they match with our calibration curve and they're more appropriate for reporting. So let's do QAQC, bromide concentrations here. So these are a little bit of the cleaned up, more cleaned up data so that we're not trying to graph again something like a negative concentration, which we know doesn't exist. I want to use an if-then statement just to make this cleaning process easier for me. If that cell is less than 0.5, which was my low detection limit, then I want Excel to give me 0.50, comma, which means otherwise, return to me whatever that value is. And here we go. We see all of these values that were less than my detection limit are now reading 0.5. So this is the first step in my data cleaning based on my detection limits. Let's go over to next the duplicate samples and check those out. Let's work this math for relative percent difference. Relative percent difference equals, I'm going to do two parentheses because I know I have a numerator and denominator, sample result minus duplicate result times 100 divided by, open my bottom parentheses, I'm actually going to do two, duplicate sample result plus my duplicate value B3, all of that divided by 2, and I get 2.4% different. I'm just going to do a control C on that cell, come down here to my next set of duplicates and do a control V to paste. I double click this to make sure I'm referring to the right cells, B4 minus B5 times 100. Divided by B4 plus B5, divided by 2. And both of those duplicate sets look like they're within my plus or minus 10%. Let's do the same thing for our check standards. My check standard solution concentration here that I know we were using in this run was 10. So we were using our highest concentration as a check standard. Let's do percent difference equals analytical, oops, gotta have the equal sign, equals analytical result of 10.54. minus my known concentration. I'm going to lock that concentration in place. You see I have those number signs. I just pressed F4. You use F4 to lock a cell in place. And then I'm going to divide by my known concentration. I'm going to lock that in place again. Press my F4. There we go. And then I'm going to times 100. My percent difference is 5.4. I'm going to do a control C on that cell, bring it down to do my next sample, my next check standard, and I'm 8.1%. Both are within plus or minus 10%. Just double checking those cells are right because I locked that D1 cell in place. Let's move to our spike recoveries and calculate these for our two sets of spike samples. We'll start with knowing that our spike solution concentration was 6 milligrams bromide per liter. That's a little bit low for a spike. You would usually use something more like 100, but this is just an example. So let's go with equals our matrix spike concentration, which in this set was 7.01, minus my unspike sample, which was 0.86, in parentheses times 100. Now I'm going to, add a parenthesis at the beginning because I had missed that. Then I'm going to divide by my known spike solution concentration, which is 6. And I'm going to lock that in place because I want to use this, I want to copy this cell for the next set of spikes also. So we have 102. Remember, we're looking for about 100% plus or minus 10%. So anywhere from 90% to 110%. We're within that range here. So I'm going to do my control C and then a control V just to make sure I'm using the right cells. That D1. The spike solution concentration we locked in place by using our F4 key. And you see I'm 97% for my second spike recovery, which is good. That's what we want. So this analytical run looks good to me. See you next time.